Doctor José Seabe, director de este Instituto de Matemáticas. Y tengo la honra de dar la bienvenida a este ciclo de conferencias en realidad del profesor James Mirlis. Conferencias que en cierta forma son inéditas, por el deseo de que las han preparado especialmente para una comunidad matemática. El Instituto de Matemáticas de la UNAM es consciente de la importancia estratégica que las matemáticas tienen para el desarrollo científico, económico y social. En esta era del conocimiento, las matemáticas son, entre otras cosas, una herramienta básica, fundamental, para entender los fenómenos de alta complejidad que entran en la sociedad actual. Por eso, el Instituto de las Matemáticas de la UNAM se complace en tener con nosotros al profesor Mirlis, quien recibió el Premio Nobel de Economía de 1996 por su contribución fundamental a la teoría de incentivos la información asimétrica. Y fue nombrado caballero Sir en Gran Bretaña en 1998. Entiendo por mis colegas economistas que en los años 70 tuvo lugar un cambio fundamental de paradigma en la economía, al centro del cual estaba el análisis de situaciones con información asimétrica. El premio Nobel a Sir James Mirlis fue la primera vez que se reconoció el premio Nobel al campo de la economía conocido como economía de la información, campo en el que posteriormente se han otorgado varios premios Nobel más. Sus contribuciones representaban un parteaguas en el desarrollo de la ciencia económica moderna, convirtiéndose en la base de campos tan diversos como las finanzas públicas, mercados financieros y amplias áreas de la teoría del consumidor. Por ello, no es exagerado decir que Sir James Mirlis se encuentra entre los más destacados premios Nobel en economía. Su trabajo es uno de los pilares fundamentales de la ciencia económica moderna. Él estudió y se graduó en matemáticas en la Universidad de Edimburgo, de donde más tarde se marchó a Cambridge para realizar su posgrado. Hizo doctorado en economía. Inicialmente especializado en economía de los países más pobres, aplicó técnicas avanzadas en matemáticas para el entendimiento de los aspectos sociales y económicos. En 1969, a los 33 años de edad, ocupó la cátedra más importante de economía de la Universidad de Oxford y fue ahí que publicó sus trabajos con los que finalmente le otorgaron el premio Nobel. En 1995, regresó como profesor de economía a Cambridge, de donde posteriormente se jubiló y es ahora profesor emérito de economía política. En 2009 fue nombrado director fundador del Colegio Morningside de la Universidad China de Hong Kong, donde sigue muy activo y en funciones. Es un gran privilegio para el Instituto de Matemáticas de la UNAM, para nuestro país, tener con nosotros a Sir James Mirlis. En estas tres conferencias nos dará una introducción clínica a estas fascinantes e importantes cuestiones sobre las cuales hay mucho por hacer y de las que quizás algunos de nuestros jóvenes estudiantes se animen a trabajar. Gracias.
Because we've used the mathematics he did, the work on game theory, which was certainly published in economic journals, so that it was deliberately intended as a contribution. Similarly, there was quite a bit in the work that Johann von Neumann did, the mathematicians have contributed quite a lot to economics, to game theory. But I'm not going to be doing any game theory. I'm taking a somewhat more old-fashioned approach to economics, because I think there still is a kind of core of economics. Much, of course, the way I see it, much of this core is things that I've had some involvement in developing over the years. So it certainly looks very different now from what it did 50 years ago. But I wanted to start by saying what kinds of things you should expect. Now, economics has models. And we tend to avoid saying that we've got theories, except in a very general sense. And that's because when we have a model, it's some kind of approximation to reality. But it may be a very remote, resemblance to reality. It's intended to be something that you can draw lessons from. If you work on it, you will see, I think, pretty clearly how that is true as we go along in the examples I'm going to be talking about, where I'm going to be mainly talking about an economy where there are sometimes many markets, sometimes only a few, and where there are eventually taxes and subsidies. So there are many things that you would recognize in the real economy. I'm not writing it away again for you, so you like it, in terms of relatively abstract principles, because I wanted really to do economics. Nevertheless, I need to put this warning in straight away, that when I say that assume that such and such is true, I'm saying that for the model. There has to be at some stage a judgment that the model is a useful approximation to reality in some way that is quite difficult. It's a major empirical judgment that one makes in any piece of applied economics. If you've got close enough, about as close as you can get. So that once I start talking, as I will tomorrow, about actually calculating what income tax rates should be, I need to use a model in order to do that. And you might think it would have to be a model that is very precisely fitted to data. But in a way, what I'm talking about is a correspondence that's not very close. It's a warning now, look out for this. And you'll see that the nature of this judgment is very interesting, completely different from what physicists do or chemists or whatever. So we are a very different kind of subject. Right, is it okay to take questions or remarks now? We may need to have a microphone. Do you want to try?
I wanted to ask you, could you comment an early lecture on this kind of judgment?
Oh, yes.
What is so different? That is, what do we have to learn to begin to be able to approach this kind of judgment? I sort of come from another side. I think we should like to actually be so kind. He's sort of commenting as you go along in the lecture on how this judgment is sort of manufactured, and you advise, please.
Yeah, it's something that one thinks one absorbs gradually. And my recollection is that I had no sense of this at all for several years when I first started the subject. So I'm not sure how well I'll be able to convey it, but certainly I intend to keep coming back to that evening. Anyway, I'm going to begin with what is the standard model in economics. Every economist ought to learn this, probably not in the form I'm going to be putting it in front of mathematicians. And you will see immediately in this thing that we get surprisingly few pieces of information from the general structure of the model. There really aren't. Initially, it will seem as though there aren't a lot of theories, there are a lot of definitions. But what's it doing? Well, I assure you that you really need to begin to try to get inside this model in order to understand at least what economists are on about. And I think it will be immediately clear what I have in mind when I said that in some respects it's so obvious and totally unrealistic. And in other ways, it's still a narrative of the way things go that could be useful. Start with saying, who are the players? Today, the players are a lot of producers and a lot of consumers. And I will actually talk about consumers as being households, since that seems to be an important characteristic of the real world, that there are little groups of people who take economic decisions together, who share meals, watch the television together, and so on. And producers, I'm not going to get into very interesting areas of economics about producers, but it will be immediately clear to you that I write down a single model for producers. And producers in the real world are enormously various. I'll have a few comments to make about that. So we've got producers and consumers, and the crucial thing is that they face crises that, from their point of view, they think are given facts. So I'm not going to bring into this model any bargaining or anything like that. You just go to the market, and there are the prices you bargain. You go and try to get a job, you ask what you'll be paid, and you simply accept it. They are what we call price takers. No government in this lecture. Getting the notation as simple as possible at the beginning, it will develop later. It's customary to define excess demand as being a function. Z is supposed to be a vector of net demands, meaning in the economy as a whole, what the sum of demands for purchase of goods or services would be, minus the sum of what the supplies of these goods and services would be. We start off by imagining this is what people are talking about when they say think about supply and demand. These are the fundamental concepts. Imagine that these are functions of prices, and it's a vector of prices. This looks pretty simple. The prices, I'm going to take the positive, it wouldn't make any sense to have them all zero, because it's only relative prices that matter. You realize straight away that I'm talking about an economy without any money. all the trade that takes place, maybe money is mentioned, but it's only a unit of account. You don't get out your credit card and have the size of your credit card account there. It's a direct exchange of goods and services for one another. Well, that's an obvious place to start. No time in the lecture course to get to my which I have to first assumption. Assumption that consumers spend all their income. You might, in a way, take it that it just has to be like that. It says that people are not going to be in equilibrium if they're not taking in as many goods measured in the unit of account, which I will, of course, call them, as they are putting out spending. So we assume they spend all their income and that all profit is paid to consumers. So nothing goes amiss in the economy. Then it follows from that, we get this equation one. So it says, at least we can say this about the excess demand function, that if you were to take in the product of the price vector, that's always going to be zero. Whether the prices are equilibrium prices or not. But I haven't said what an equilibrium is yet. An equilibrium is shown in two, the inequalities there. But say Z of B star is non-positive. Of course, the reason why we don't simply say equal to zero is because it's easy to think that cases where the price might possibly be zero and there could be an excess supply. If you have a machine that you use for many years, it eventually becomes obsolete. It's worth nothing. You throw it away. I'm not saying there are never problems about that, but there's an excess supply of out-of-date machines. It still counts as an equilibrium if the price has gone to zero. So that now we already have a concept. And this is supposed to correspond to a real world in which indeed there are prices, and in which, of course, for various reasons that we should go into later, people's demands and supplies will vary from time to time. And there's a lot hidden behind this. Things like what the distribution of income will come out to be. Because amongst these prices are wage rates. And the interest that people get paid on that. It must have been taken for granted that people first started thinking that an economic equilibrium would be a situation where demands and supplies are essentially equal, except for the case of few goods. But think about it, why would, in a situation like this, why would you actually expect that there will be possibly a price vector, or certainly a price vector, that will satisfy two? What's the intuition behind it? I've no idea where people got it from, but I'll show you the simplest argument I know that at least makes it very plausible that there is an equilibrium price vector. Certainly, it better be continuous. You wouldn't have much hope of getting an equilibrium if it wasn't. But it seems kind of plausible for a number of reasons that Z should be a continuous pattern. For example, we think it the demands and supplies are made up of the demands and supplies of many, many different people and firms. And they vary. Everyone is unique to some extent. So that it seems unlikely when the price changes. somehow I will get the same response from everybody. But that might be enough to give you this continuity, but it seems to be not right. Now, starting from Z, we can construct the mapping, which is what I'm going to do. You can see it at the screen, clearly it's rather low down, that we're going to be defining a mapping from the set of prices into itself. But the set of prices, which I'm calling capital P just for the moment, is one that we can turn into a nice convex compact set, which is a very good thing to have, of course. And we get our mapping very easily by saying, starting from excess demand, which if you're not at an equilibrium, will be some positive, some negative. We know that from one, so there's going to be some positive excess demand and some negative excess demand, otherwise that would hold. So let's just increase the price by excess demand in every market, whether positive or negative. But if P plus Z turns out to be negative, let's just replace that with zero. So it's defined in my language. Well, that's fine, but of course, this mapping Q doesn't immediately map from P into itself. But it's very easy to... So we do the obvious thing and normalize so that we can keep prices always adding up to one. The reason we can do that is because, as I said, only relative prices matter. And prices can't always be zero. And we want to put non-negative prices. I mean, maybe it's a question of negative ones. So we normalize. And F is defined as being Q divided by something. In other words, we normalize Q in the same way that P would have been normalized before. But we get a fixed point here. We start by Brouwer's fixed point theory. And right, that justifies the presumed intuition that there should be price equilibrium. But if we think about that, where there are still problems. Before I move on to why that is actually not yet a very satisfactory result, and why economists of mathematical persuasion put a lot of effort into getting a more satisfactory theory, let me just comment on this obsession with equilibrium. Why I talk about equilibrium? Well, of course, the physical analogy is quite good there, statics and dynamics. But in physics, you have dynamics. And the dynamics moves you in cases where it works nicely to an equilibrium. Of course, the equilibrium might be in a particular science. So it would be the kind of thing that I'm talking about here. In economics, we'd be very hard put to it to write down a good model of dynamics in this sense. I will indeed do that. You can see already the three up there at the top of the page. Suggests a possible way of adjusting prices. But it is certainly suggested by that idea. But that's not the way the world works to a large extent. And that might be quite important. But our feeling is that this is identifying sometime before we're out of it. And I then want to say, and in a lot of important situations, it doesn't work that way. And I thought, because I want to get a lot of economics into these lectures, and although this isn't so much an admirable point, please don't assume that I think that having an equilibrium is the be-all and end-all of economics. What we want to get at. We'll see why not shortly. However, onto the standard model still, which was, is very much an equilibrium model. But let me explain what is the main problem of the setup so far. If you think what are plausible technologies for producers, we didn't write down anything explicit about producers. But if they have some way of doing, making things, what I'm really talking about will become maybe clearer once I write down the formula. If you've got a way of doing something, suppose you've found a way of setting up a factory that will produce 1,000 t-shirts a week. Well, then you could build another factory, and then you would be producing 2,000 t-shirts a week. And you'd have what we call constant returns, because you have doubled the inputs and doubled the output. And under these circumstances, if we ask what the supplies might be as a function of price, we have to say, well, if the price for t-shirts is just right, it just covers cost, the cost of the inputs, then you don't mind what scale you produce at, because you'll make just enough money to pay for the inputs for what you sell. If the price is bigger than that, then there is no limit on how much you can produce. And if the price is less than that, you won't be the same. So it doesn't actually make sense to talk about the supply function for the producer. And since a lot of industry, by no means all, by no means, but a lot of industry has this characteristic of constant returns, like coming back to we've got to do something else. We've also got to justify the continuity that I spoke of and made one possible argument for continuity. So we have to get behind things and make more detail of the model. That's what we do. First, the household. The household chooses what to do. So now the way I'm going to write it is to maximize a function, which will be called utility. Clearly, there are many functions that would do equally well. You could take a monotonic transformation of this function, that would be fine. You could write it, which is what De Broglie certainly did, and most economic theorists have done since then, in terms of the best thing on some given preference ordering, which doesn't have particular properties. But I'm going to want this language later, tomorrow. So I'm going to take it now. And consumers are supposed to choose their trade vector. Say a little bit more about trade. XH is trade by household wage. It consists of some positive components, like how much you buy of various consumer goods that you don't happen to be growing in your own garden, you want to consume. Some of these components might be negative, if you actually grow so much in your own garden that you sell it. So you don't mind that. And some of these negative items for labor, for example. So labor supply would appear as a negative component in the XH vector.
What's the constraint? It's not just that P.x, the inner product of prices and quantities, is equal to the income, the pure income, P.h, of the consumer. You wonder about the income, we'll come to that thing. But also, x must be feasible in the sense that the consumer doesn't starve. I will want to comment more on that. So only some trade vectors are actually possible for the consumer. It depends on the consumer, what sort of endowment the consumer has. Many consumers start life with essentially no endowment, except, of course, that they are capable of doing a certain amount of work. There are some assumptions that are needed in the standard algebra in order to get an equilibrium. And UH concave is a bit strong. Although in some ways not quite strong enough. And I don't want to get into the precise details of this, but I just say concave more or less. And the XH, of course, has to be closed and convex. Otherwise, you would get all kinds of discontinuities. Or even non-existence of XH and the price of it. Quickly moving on to producers. The producer maximizes profit, which is the inner product of prices and the net supply vector by the producer. And Y is in the, a set that describes the technological possibilities. The YH has to be closed and convex. That's actually a bit stronger than is really required. So, I think it's best to make a strong assumption now and point out that there are a lot of technologies for which this wouldn't be true. Production of things like software programs, operating systems, and books. It isn't really complex. So there are a lot of things we're missing when we do this. Well, it needs work to be done beyond the hours we're here. I promise to show where the household income comes from, but it comes from the distribution of profits of N. This is, as my recollection, the way that De Broglie does it in his famous group theory that he simply assumes that for each firm there is some proportion of those for each of the households. But it's entirely possible that each firm is owned by a single household, and that most households don't have any shares in profit. But that's, of course, not excluded. Right. Yeah, that's just filling in that the beetles have to sum to one for each producer J. And with pretty much these assumptions, you can show that an equilibrium PCR exists. Very useful theorem here is one of Kakatani, which applies to what he calls correspondences, not functions, where you map from price vector P into a set, into sets, the corresponding stage becomes sets. And provided the graph of the correspondence is closed, then everything goes through nicely. That has to be sure. It's time that we said a little bit more about the stability issue. And it comes up in the inquiry. There's absolutely no reason to expect uniqueness. But there are cases where you get it. the test that most of the literature has used in thinking about stability of equilibrium is to imagine that there's a process. It's easier to write it down sensibly in the first model rather than this more extended model that I just described as a standard model, by supposing that prices go up or down at a rate that depends on the excess demand. Sounds kind of plausible. Think about it, though, if you think about the real world, then you want to know how you think of these things. I think it seems like the way things ought to go, rather than being a response to thinking, well, that's how it actually happens in reality. Certainly, if for some market there is an excess of demand over supply, then you would think that some of the producers will try to raise price. But of course, the main reaction will be to increase supply if it's popular to do so. So maybe that's a much more important feature, except if it is. Now, of course, you don't get global stability, meaning convergence of the price over time. Time tends to think the theoretical price here to something. But there is a result, interesting enough, that the time that I indicated where there are areas that you can actually get something quite interesting. There's a neat little theorem that says there are only two moods, then indeed it's globally stable and you certainly don't get any equilibrium. In some ways, although it's rather a special result, the gross substitutes theorem is more interesting. It says that if the excess demand for commodity I is an increasing function of all the other prices, but not, of course, of the EI itself, then it would have to be a decreasing function. Then the process 14 is stable and it converges to the intermediate equilibrium. And it's quite a nice little theorem. And I think it probably qualifies as the kind of thing that most people could prove. But we might take a little while. I actually am going to want to refer back to that surprising context. So I thought it was particularly worth mentioning. But since we're talking about stability, this is, oddly enough, rather a good place to introduce the whole question of Keynesian unemployment. Because, of course, Keynesian unemployment is a situation where there is an excess supply of labor, and where, in some sense, obviously not the sense that we're talking about here, the economy would be in a sort of equilibrium. Actually, I tend to think we might as well admit that it wouldn't actually be in equilibrium, but it would stay well away from ordinary equilibrium unless there's some intervention. To think about this, here I'm illustrating the way economists tend to go about trade. Consider a model with a consumption group and labor, let's say just two groups. Now I know I said the two groups to get global stability, but now we look a bit more carefully for this particular application and think quite seriously how do labor markets work. How do product markets really work? Suppose somehow or other you get into a situation where there is unemployment of labor, that's to say, people want to work, but they can't find jobs. Some people do, drunk enough liquor. Well, under these circumstances, what we're talking about suggests that not in any sort of wager fault. Wager extent is rather sticky, and more than orthodox economists are interested, of course. They're so sticky that this doesn't really work. However, that's not quite the view that came to. And if you look at what has happened in Spain and Portugal and Greece in recent years, you have quite considerable changes in wheelchairs. That doesn't surprise me. What one has to look at more carefully is the goods market. Because at the same time, according to the theory that I've been putting forward, there would be an excess demand for goods. And of course, that's exactly not what you see in these circumstances. What you see in these circumstances is that demand is insufficient, and that producers appear to be, they would have been willing to produce more if only they thought they could sell it. But they don't because they can't. And if they produce more, they would employ more people, and that would move towards the desired state of the employment. Why not? What goes wrong? Well, when I talked about demand, and particularly when I wrote down the standard model and said X, H, remember the vector of net trades that the consumer wants to do, maximizes his utility subject to the constraints, and he chooses the whole range of things in this model, both consumption and labor. So he decides he would like to work. And if he decides working and getting a wage for it, he would also like to spend that money that he earns for consumption. Now, as Keynes pointed out, that excess demand is not effective demand. There's no sign of it, in fact. People don't make that kind of calculation. They're not so stupid as to go out and demand goods when they actually don't have a job that pays them enough to buy them. So the way it's been set up has turned out to be misleading once we start trying to do the dynamics of the situation. So I wanted to, since I'm really keen to tell you about economics, I wanted to show you where these issues, these called macroeconomic issues, the question of unemployment, comes in to this kind of theory, but there isn't time for us to begin to explore too far. So let's hurry on, I'm sorry. Anyway, I think that's a very good example of what's been going on and is still going on in Southern Europe. I thought because the thing that is very obviously missing once you start talking about what's going on in Southern Europe is the issue of international trade. So I want to show you rather quickly that the sort of structure that I set up has some rather interesting things to say about international trade. But we have to introduce some new ideas to deal with this. So we distinguish now between goods that are produced and goods that aren't produced, like labor and land. Now I want to say a little bit more about the relationship between the prices of the two. We can, if those costs were times to scale everywhere, that's the simplest one to do. We can define the minimum unit cost of producing commodity I. By unit cost, I mean, of course, the cost of producing one unit of I. there's technology available, it's just got that capital Y, and what's the back through on the book, on the screen or whatever. And of course, this and of course depends on prices. And these prices are prices of produced goods, so I still call it P, and prices of non-produced goods, so I call it W. So we have an equilibrium condition because the constant flux of scale, you can't have profits, because meaning prices exceed cost. The price exceeds cost, you're not in equilibrium, because the producer wants to produce everything they can. So you must have a condition that I've written in 16. Where PI is less than or equal to the cost function. And we get equality of YMI. But the commodities that are actually produced, the equilibrium prices are determined uniquely by government because of that gross substitutes theory that I mentioned. That unique equilibrium and the function. Which was then the excess demand function, there, but now is the function C. And we get prices of function, prices of output goods, produced goods, as a function of the prices of not produced goods. If you thought that that happens rather quickly and easily all the time. And this might be a rather better way of thinking about the way the prices get confirmed. Then you can plug this into the various demand functions. It essentially reduces you to saying that your demands and supplies can be thought of as not thought of non-produced goods. We thought of as functions of the prices of the non-produced goods. So it reduces the whole business of finding equilibrium, finding the prices of the non-produced goods, which may not be many. And that then gets you to the prices of produced goods by 17. So it enormously changes or appears to change the dimension of the problem. Because we really do like models with labor and maybe land with the capital, not very many of these goods. And this gives some curious ideas when we think about international trade. Because with international trade, we would want to distinguish between those goods that are internationally traded from trading. And those that are not. For a moment I had thought to give electricity as an example of a non-trading good that was certainly Britain buys electricity from France and France buys electricity from Britain because they have different peak hours. So because the clock is different across the world. Land's obviously not trading, so it's not quite the issue. So if you get the idea that not a lot of goods can be traded relative to the number that are not tradable, I think that's right. I have once developed a model where the cost of trading varied from good to good and applied it to, say, half of Pakistan, where it proved impossible to discuss which sectors ought to operate and which sectors really ought to close down. If you simply have this distinction between the trade and the non-trade goods, in general equilibrium, each country should specialize in the production of as many traded goods as there are non-produced factory production goods. Which suggests considering Broadway Park, that is entirely right. And it's an interesting teaching of the real world, how it very different it is from the theory. So it looks as though countries that specialize in the same commodity should be the same factor prices, the W's. Looks, this suggested itself, people because they look at 17 and said that if the P's are handled for trading goods, then they're the same with the countries. And maybe maybe the P is the same with the countries, W is the same with the countries. Well, you look at the world and you see the wages and it is very different in different countries. But on the other hand, you would assume the way I put it, the world, is that sorry, it's split between the countries, is that countries that share the same specialization, so it's the same number of segments of specialization as non-traded goods, should have the same factor prices, or the fingering factor prices, which are quite different one or other of a few possible solutions to invert in that equation. And therefore, expect to get discontinuous changes in equilibrium prices, each change in economic conditions. And remarkable stability over quite long periods, too. To begin to get some experience. Now, I want to finish off. I see that, I think I was given an hour. So that allows me to go off another 10 minutes. So I'm just about due for interjecting that movement. And what I want to do here is to deal with what ought to be something nagging at you all the time. Like writing down models where, although I talked about time and I had the DP, equals say, equation, it wasn't real time. Some kind of adjustment process that failed quickly. But very important feature of the economy develops over time. Aaron Burr suggested simply extending their model by a labeling device. They would say, everything I've written down so far, I should just go back and insist that XI includes not only what you want to buy and sell now, but what you're planning to buy and sell next year and the year after, and so on. And similarly with producers. And equilibrium then would mean that excess demand should be zero, not only for goods in this period, but for goods next year, the year after, and in the century's time. Of course, this was a move that what one could see was likely to create trouble. But it's very difficult to know exactly what to do about the prices for goods in the future. The price for whether the goods are positive or negative. It's clear one isn't going to use this model in a very exact way in correspondence with reality. On the other hand, it's certainly true that if there were going to be a difference in demand and supply, the people thinking about this and trying to forecast it, if it really mattered to them, ought to have some kind of model of the kind of plan to do it. Anyway, that was really the position that often comes to Congress in that case. I want to show you that it is indeed possible to do some quite interesting economic analysis with this kind of setup. You will see that I'm doing something very special. But what I'm really wanting to discuss is the question, what should we expect to happen to the prices of property in urban areas and in countries as the economies grow? It's a very frequent complaint in China, especially in Hong Kong, but also in London, that prices get very high. And there's an obvious question whether that can be simply blamed on the supply we have, or whether it's some kind of speculative phenomenon. So we should be precise about this, right? So I'm really showing you how one might do it. But I'll create as simple a model as possible that would do the job. It's got to be dynamic. It's got to go on all the time. So there's got to be capital in here. Now, we'll pretend that capital is just stuck. Just an accumulation of that. Modern speaker used to call it a cog. It accumulated. A seed. Or you could consume it. And the other commodity we're going to talk about here is land, which is A. And of course, A is fixed. You probably don't find that too strange an assumption here. But Hong Kong's made a lot of land. Get it back from the sea. We don't count the sea as land. The second one is. So we've got output. We can still think of production function. It says output is a function of both the quantity of land and the quantity of capital, even although the quantity of land is not going to change in the model. But what we're thinking of is that this is a production function that applies to everybody in the economy who has a bit of land and a bit of capital. So there should be constant balance. So we normally put labor in here as well, but I want to keep things as simple as possible to get the job. Now, land output can either be used for consumption or for investment. Investment means increase in capital. That is complicated differential. Actually, I want it to be homogeneous if it's one and two. Or producers will maximize output minus the cost of land, the cost of using land for a single time period. If you use the rent, there should be a rent for that minus the cost of using capital for that R is the rate of interest, which is a way of expressing the idea of the future costs of the goods next period, which you believe in. So pure annual value, R, the interest rate, because of that maximization potentiality, we've got 20, which says that Q is the partial derivative of F. Respect to A and I is the partial derivative of respect to K. So, what would be the simplest possible theory of demand here? It's one that has appealed to many people over the years as an account of what countries do might invest, say, fixed proportions S of the outer field. So K dot is S times M. Well, in other words, I've said the whole history of the economy to now we've worked out. K is determined. There's an initial stock of capital K is 0. And we go on from there because A is constant. S is a constant. So that, so have we dealt with it? No. People are worried about the price of land. What about what's the price of land? That's not the same as what's the price of using land for a year. The question is, what is the price of land? Call it P. Someone who buys land must get the same return over the year as she would have had for investing in capital. Now, if you buy land, you will get a capital gain, like a loss, P dot, over the very short time period, if you continuous time. And also, you get the rent rate, pretty good at time. So, you get P dot plus Q. If instead you use the money not to invest in land, but to invest in capital, and the amount of money in question is P, you would get R. You've got to be indifferent between these, and that is going to tell us the price. So you see, we have an neat little differential equation to tell us what the price of land would be. This is all implicitly making the Heidegger assumption that you can treat future goods the same. You haven't gone very far in the future, so it's silent. But we're assuming that capital markets work. You're going to ignore differences amongst people in the environment of land. Sorry, but this bit is just a bit. I thought about this, and I didn't really want to. It's an interesting line of territory, which you've probably read by now, but I move on to the notes. I'm sorry, page 4 has dropped off. But I can tell you what. This is an equation that you can solve. What I do in fact in the remaining page is to take a very special form of F, namely A to the power times K to the power, where the two powers add up to 1. A to the alpha times K to the minus alpha. And for that you can work out explicitly what P is. Now, not saying it's a mathematical defined here, not too surprising that you can sometimes solve the differential equation, especially such as something like this. You get one solution that is P over K constant. And you get a lot of solutions that has P equal to that constant times K plus an arbitrary constant, which you will see has to be positive, times K to a power bigger than 1. You would have seen explicitly that what that power is. I mentioned alpha a moment ago, it's alpha over X. Then minus alpha over X. But you probably didn't take a note of that. It doesn't matter so much. But the point is that P would be growing faster than capital in all these other paths. How will you say, right, well, what's the initial? You just wanted to know the initial value of P. But there's nothing to tell us the initial value. In other words, I've described an economic model where there is not just non-unique equilibrium, but there's a whole continuum of equilibrium. defined by the constant integration scale from solvable equation. Now I do wish I had page 4 here to show you, because then we think, we look carefully at the solution, and we say, if S is big, too big, not terribly big, even 1 minus alpha, then the price seems to be always big. And you think, not all of us actualize, you could start at a positive level, but we'll certainly come back. What's going on? Well, actually, if S is too big in this model, but we've got the fantasy here, it's quite bad. That's one. What's hidden behind 22 is the idea of looking at what we call the present value of future rents. And present value, of course, is something that we can find in lots of money programs and so on, it's very important to people dealing with assets. You discount future rents using the interest rates in the bill between now and then. I don't mean that the interest rate is constant, I mean the interest rate is here. But actually, if S is bigger than that, the value, the discounted value is infinite. So the problem is actually not that P wants to be negative, but that P wants to be infinite. So if S is too big, there is no equilibrium in the sense that you're talking about for the price of land. So I'm going to take enough time to go on the further step to show you. If you think about 21, this assumption of the proportional income is saved, it might occur to you that when there is land there, which people own, that F is not people's income. If F is only the income from wages and the carbon capital, but you should put in probably the income that they get from having a capital gain and land. And also, of course, the income they earn from it. And you should do the same on the other side. The savings goes partly into accumulation of capital, but partly into increasing the wealth in the form of land value. Because P is maybe increasing, some of the wealth can go into that. Well, it turns out that the equation you get from that assumption leaves you with only one path on which both P and K remain positive forever. On all the other additional P's, you get a path where either P goes to zero at finite time or K goes to zero at finite time. So neither of these is a positive equilibrium. So already in the simplest possible model, you find that sometimes you get a unique equilibrium. Sometimes you get indeterminacy of equilibrium, which must imply great uncertainty. Sometimes you get no equilibrium at all. And considering that China has been saving half of the GDP, actually, China could be a country which could be in the situation where having a market for land would get them into all kinds of trouble because of the tendency of the price to go on up and up to manage to stop the kind of moral say at the end of page 4 of my lecture, is that the markets for assets can be a great sum of trouble. And actually, the same sorts of considerations lay behind the recommendation by Robert Mandel, Michael Lisi, and others, of having the euro as a common currency for European countries. Because monies are another example of assets where crude wealth have similar kinds of problems. And yet, of course, that comes out to be, as I think, a mistake. Thank you very much. That's today's lecture. And tomorrow, we'll join the government.
Vamos a tener ahorita un minuto de preguntas con la prensa. Les invito a que nos acompañen y después hay preguntas abiertas para todos ustedes.
Gracias, director. Tenemos solo tres preguntas.
Doctor, buenas tardes. Quisiera ver si nos pudiera explicar qué fue lo que falló en el sur de Europa, en la Unión Europea, para ser más concreto, respecto al modelo educativo, el modelo económico, perdón, que ha metido a varios países en una crisis. Gracias.
I wonder if I could ask the interpreters to interpret again.
Doctor, si pudiera explicarnos qué falló en el modelo económico de la Unión Europea que metió, entiendo, a varios países, entre ellos en el sur de este continente, en una crisis económica. Gracias.
Simple little question. Now, which I probably don't know enough to be an authority. But of course, starting from what I said before, it goes straight to the Spanish problem of house prices collapsing. Much as they did in the United States. But that was not the only thing that went wrong. That causes problems because people who have lent money for buying of houses feel that they are going to face a serious risk of default. Now, what I honestly don't know is how serious that risk was at the scale. But the size of the price point is not. It would make people very pessimistic. It wasn't the only thing that happened. Because many of the European banks, in the south as well as in the north, have been investing in financial derivatives, which lost a lot of value when we're talking about trillions. So normal lending institutions, banks particularly, became very much poorer than they rather quickly sharply. The bank gets poor. And what does it do? It decides it doesn't want to do nearly as much risky lending to people. You might say it just doesn't have the money to do it. I'm not quite sure that that's right. I think it's rather the attitude towards risk. So certainly the levels of investment fell very sharply. And this is one of the possibilities that sort of built into the capital. risky investment. That may only mean that once in 25 years or so, there will be a really big loss. But there's a lot of evidence that people underestimate the likelihood of these large falls in value. But I think it's not so much that people are getting things wrong that way, because most bankers came out of it pretty well. Many of them got large bonuses and so on. So they clearly weren't severely punished for being very serious risk takers. So when they did the investment in the past and decided to put a lot of their lending into buying financial assets rather than lending to producers and consumers, they had no reason to worry. These were especially risky. But probably they assumed they would be bailed out, or if not bailed out, that they would end up with a very nice sum of money from there. So I think these are main features. But there's one other feature which I think was quite important, which is that commodity prices have been going up quite a lot, particularly the price of oil. And when these prices go high, the people who are buying them have less money to spare for buying other things. So that's another way in which demand fell. And it's the falling of demand that is the immediate cause of the unemployment. That had made me hope that now when the oil prices come down, the commodity prices are much lower, that we would get out of it much faster than we have. But of course, so I actually have to explain not only why in 2008 the European economy went bad, but why in 2015 it's still in a pretty dreadful state. And then demand should recover. But no, there are very big components of demand that depend on whether people expect growth, serious growth in the future, and therefore good demand. And it appears that people are still very pessimistic. I hate to use such a remark as an explanation, but since I think it's true.
Sí, gracias, doctor. Jacqueline Jiménez, teléfono.
Doctor, buenas tardes. En alcance al escenario que usted ha tenido a bien de comenzar a describirnos, quisiera preguntarle, en su mayor momento de crisis en España, ¿usted le sugería, entre otras alternativas, salir usted del euro y subsidiar el empleo? En economías de países emergentes como el nuestro, ¿qué le recomendaría a un gobierno para comenzar a alejarse de esa situación de crisis y disminuir su dependencia de la producción y venta de hidrocarburos?
I realize I should perhaps not have got into a long discussion of real. Real world economies, because of course the lecture was intended for mathematicians, and it seems to me that we should take the time to let the mathematicians ask questions. Of course, this is another very big question. Since my ignorance of the Mexican economy is incredibly deep. I must say it, I really can't answer that. I'm very tempted to get into my reasons for thinking was not much better. And actually that, to get out of the euro, at least for the southern countries to get out of the euro. And indeed, I did say something about Keynesian economics in the lecture, so I could just say that a very important aspect of this is that if a country does something to increase effective demand, for example, by government spending on improved unemployment benefits or something like that, then quite a lot of the further effect of increased demand could go into buying more imports. So part of the demand spills over into other countries. That's a good thing, of course, because other countries need more demand as well. But clearly the problem that we have in Europe is that some countries are getting a much smaller share of demand for exports than others. And that's because the effective cost of their labor is rather high. Now, of course, what's been happening is that the wages have fallen in these countries, and the Orthodox, the Germans and so on, they'll say, that's what's wanted. It's falling wages we want, not a devaluation of the exchange rate. But, of course, if the wages fall, then, as I was explaining in the lecture, demand by the wage earners falls, so that offsets the possible advantage that you get more export demand from other countries because you're now a cheaper place. But you're going to get less demand from your own people because they're not so well off. And I think actually the only way to get around that problem. Devaluation isn't perfect, okay? But I'm glad you mentioned the labor subsidies, because I think that's an important part of the description. I've no idea that applies to Mexico. but I should have one thing. The last time I was in Mexico, just as I was leaving, there was a very large devaluation. And I'm still ashamed of the fact that my hotels cost me much less than I expected.
Gracias. Terminamos con Alberto González de Financiero.
Sí, buenas tardes, profesor. Parte de su modelo habla del equilibrio, y ahorita en México tenemos un debate de subir el salario mínimo y sin que eso signifique inflación, sin que signifique eso que suban los precios, toda esta parte. Desde su punto de vista como economista, ¿se puede subir el salario mínimo? ¿Estaría a favor o estaría en contra de manera, digamos, teórica?
I'm wondering if we're not moving a bit into the press conference, which is supposed to follow.
This is the press conference. This is it.
Ah,
this is.
I see. Okay. Well, how awful for all the mathematicians. Be polite. But by the way, I have some difficulty in understanding. I wonder if you could just repeat the question.
Si usted cree que se podría perder el equilibrio en la economía mexicana, una economía como México, si de manera el gobierno subiera el salario mínimo por decreto.
You're saying that the minimum wage gets adjusted when prices change, I suppose.
I don't think
en meses días pasados se comenzó a discutir a nivel de cámaras la posibilidad de eliminar el salario mínimo en el país por parte de algunos sectores y de otros la propuesta de revisarlo e incrementarlo conforme la inflación se fuera comportando. Lo que quisiéramos que ustedes nos compartieran su punto de vista respecto a si una medida como esta fuera una u otra la decisión rompería el equilibrio del escenario económico del país a partir de lo que usted nos estuvo comentando en su ponencia.
Some very interesting empirical work, both in the United States and in Europe, which shows, contrary to economists' previous expectations, that a higher minimum wage in one part of the area as compared to another would lead to higher employment rather than lower employment. Now, I think that there are a number of reasons why that might be right, which none of them are the reasons that were in the model so popular. I think I won't get into that. Well, what I believe for the moment, it's conjecture, is that as you raise the minimum wage from a very low level, that you probably manage to make the labor market more competitive, and that has the advantage of getting an increase in employment because the marginal labor cost of employing more people may fall or rise. But if you keep on doing it, it can't be true. So the issue is very much, how high is the minimum wage now? And I don't quite know. I think the European minimum wage is already distinctly above the level, particularly in the Mediterranean countries, where further increase is quite a bad effect on long-term demand for labor. But as we've been saying already, increasing the wage, unless there's a big reduction in the number of people employed, it immediately increases demand. So that's likely to offset any tendency to employ more people. So you expect a very different effect depending on whether there's quite a bit of unemployment already, or whether you've got a fully employed economy. And that's what I don't know about Mexico. But I would prefer subsidies for employing low-wage labor rather than the minimum wage as a way of ensuring that people at the lower end of the income scale get an adequate income. Kind of tax for it.
Ahora tenemos unos minutos para preguntas del público abierta. Tenemos unos minutos para preguntas de ustedes. Ahora si quieren hablar, creo que levanten las manos y llevaremos el micrófono. Pido que sean muy concisos.
So I'd rather ask this in English, if you don't mind, so there's nothing lost in translation. So there's a very pressing debate in economy in general, but here in Mexico, about creative destruction. So I'm sure you've heard of this problem. There's an app called Uber, which what it does is contacts people with cars, with private cars, and they essentially use them as taxis. So a person who wants to move from A to B, I have my private car, et cetera, et cetera. That is very present, say, in the US with the hotel industry, and people using their apartments as housing for other people, et cetera, et cetera. So my question is, will creative destruction end in this sort of way we do politics, say, because all these things are illegal, right? With the current laws. So my question is, do you think this wave of new business models can be stopped within the present frame of law, or will it change the way we do economic politics?
Creative destruction is a term that economists use, goes back to Schumpeter, for the way in which new innovations of any kind, whether like the ones you're talking about, or inventions or whatever, come into the economy, making money for people who don't have money, and at the same time, taking money away from the people who were in these markets before that, who don't have the latest ideas becoming obsolescent. We regard it as a good thing because this is. It creates incentives to get costs down and buy things that people want to keep the economy growing. It's an important theme that kind of growth here. And I think indeed that Uber things like that is a very interesting example of just that. In many countries, if it's not illegal, it would be illegal not to pay taxes on it as a result of doing it. Similarly, for a long time they were renting rooms in their houses to get a lot of bed and breakfast and very stylish trailers. Quite a public government. As far as I know, people pay the taxes. Again, that was a good development. But of course, the particular feature that I think will draw attention to is that it's become much easier to make a market work, which is a it's not a barter market, but it's a market between individuals who are normally consumers who don't think of themselves as producers. There was certainly, it's as though we're moving back to sometimes to a much smaller scale. Do I think that we will find that hotels all close down and people will stay with strangers? No, I don't think that, because that possibility has been there for a long time. So I guess Uber will do quite well. Of course, there was something rather similar in London, that taxes were not licensed. what we're getting into here to some extent is government regulation. And in many cities, the taxes are fixed and licensed, and it becomes a well, on the face of it, it's absurd to the situation where in order to become a taxi driver or to run a taxi firm, you may have to spend a lot of money, you may have to get a little back in order to buy the license from, because it's scarce. Because the reason for doing that is partly to make sure that our economic but it was sort of questionable. It wasn't done for traffic reasons. Reasonable, but in that case, it would have been better to auction it as many places you check out in terms of car licenses, rather than limiting the number of licenses. So it would be good. So what you're talking about, there's all kinds of possible difficulties and so on. The basic thing, it sounds like a really advantageous business, eBay and things like that. You can have very easy to cheap communication. Probably most, many of us would have thought that this would run into great difficulties over fraud, because to know whether you were dealing with somebody trustworthy. That's the advantage that shops in the high street have. Maybe it might have been there for years. Maybe it's unlikely that it goes down because of the delivery of order. And so far, as I understand it, we've been pretty successful. Just pretty much a comment on the principles that guide human behavior. I have the problems.
Just going back to the model, I might ask you to the point. We write down like differential equations in simple physical or biological problems. There are some sort of parameters which are sort of measured by some sort of experiment, sort of fixed like time scale of the approach to equilibrium. Is there an analog in economics? Is it correct to think about that? I mean, when you have this degenerative equilibrium, is it because there is something inherent in sort of how the economics works? And that will sort of give like an algebraic time scale of approach. Is that again an element of judgment? Does it have any bearing in the actual economics of this? I think I cannot have this point to this slide.
In the case of the model of the price of land, then that was an entirely equilibrium model. So I didn't suggest any explanation as to how the price might get there. So it seems to me that equilibrium is not unique. There's an intrinsic problem with assets, because the price of the asset now is going to be the price for using the asset, the rental. Plus the discounted expected price that you need to get for it to be sold in the year's time. So there's nothing there about the sort of approach to the equilibrium that you're talking about. It seems to me to capture a real phenomenon. And just showing how it really can answer the question that you asked in the first place. That's what I didn't say, like written on the missing page, was that, of course, as the price land become quite a large multiple of the national income. You would expect that people would be more and more unwilling to lend money for the purchase of that land. In other words, they would want to charge a higher interest than the interest rate that would imply. And out the derivative about the same capital and something like that. However, what you were really interested in was the other stability issues that I raised so briefly earlier on. And this is something that very little serious empirical work has been done on this. That I know, because I think on the whole that people don't believe that there's enough constancy in the behavior. So you might find how exactly how a trade is working at the moment in the stock market. It's an interesting case of how the prices for shares return. Stockbrokers are busily trying to find people in both the demand and the supply, and even the price. All the time they're guided by what the prices mean and their sense of which way it must be moving. So, of course, people have described exactly this being done. We've moved to a situation of a lot of computer trading. This is an entirely typical situation. There are a lot of trading that is done by computer program. I don't know how they decisions on whether to go by the price or not. And for other people, we won't be able to find one who we always have. But it's in almost all cases it's very important to use some kind of intervention. You can see how important retail trade is. But when a lot of markets are bargaining going on, as you might be through Mexico, it's even harder to describe exactly. You don't expect it to work at all. The last remark I want to make about that is that it's so different in the market. Millions of the markets, some of them very small. So when you've got an idea like the one I talked about, where you say prices are equal to the cost function, you say, let's not think about how you get there. But it is indeed quite a bit of evidence. Many markets, producers set the price between the cost of the market. And that at least gives a nice straightforward answer. But there are other prices out there that keep changing. So if you look at, say, electricity, but not households, people who run the grid, transmission, buying from the producers, power stations. There the price of electricity where we go, that's by limit, is done by the computer generated options. There are just so many different kinds of price setting going on. models that set this kind of policy. So I wasn't dealing with situations that I think may be different than the other. As indeed was true of that, the square meter of the back is a different object. So that is exactly the problem. It shows that the sense in which you think you can properly draw lessons from the model, because it looks enough like part of the other.
Bueno, pues les agradezco mucho a todos. Mañana tenemos a todos invitados que tenemos otra conferencia y una sesión de preguntas mañana. Están todos invitados, por favor, agradezcamos. Thank you.